Well, with the drummer, no, okay, I wasn't, no.
But I am in music.
Yeah.
Okay. I picked up on the vibe.
So now you want one?
Maybe. Yeah. Like dinner?
I wish you would like coffee. This one, this is, look at this one. Betty Toto.
Yeah. How old are
you? You want one?
Yeah.
I don't know.
You don't know me?
That's right.
Oh, wait,
there's
one thing I have to do.
Yeah,
the
boardwalk.
You made it?
You bought it.
You bought it?
You bought it?
You bought it?
Yeah, bought it. Yeah, bought it. Yeah, bought it.
You all, for me, it's been way too long. We took the month of August off, and it feels like we took about a year off. And I can see for some of you, it seems like it was a little too long for you, too. And I can also see that you're no longer here to hear what information I provide. You are here to visit with each other. And I happen to be here, too, so I can visit with all of you. Don't forget that the meeting in December, I might as well tell you now, when we have our meeting in December, we always extend the length so that it can be social, too. So you have that to look forward to as well. All right? Plan ahead. okay, so it really is nice to see everybody. It feels to me like it's been a lot longer than just 2 months.
Yeah.
It really does feel like it's, you know, half a year at least. I know I did the Sunset Seminar out in Southampton. Say that three times fast. And a lot of you were there, so that gave some continuity, but it's still not the same as us being together here. So it is nice to see everybody again, and I appreciate you coming out. I appreciate that Grace found her way. She was the one person that didn't make it to the Sunset Seminar because she was lost in Southampton for an hour and a half. So let's give a special round of applause.
So we were all lost. You were found.
Yes, exactly. We were all lost trying to find Grace. But it is nice to be back with everybody. I do want to start off talking about the September Heart Walk. I'm not going to say much about it. Of course, I'm going to let Michelle talk about it from American Heart. The only thing I do want to tell you, my part in this, is that you guys asked if there was a way that we could come together for those who want to walk. So we put it on my website, created a team. Michelle's the team captain. I'm the co-captain. All you have to do is go onto the page to register and put in the letters EPG for the group, Enlightenment Power Group. Once you do EPG, you have an option of either joining the team, which will be on your right side, or in the middle it says more information. You can click on EPG itself, and then you can just make a donation if you don't have the opportunity to be there that day. But I did want you to know that you asked, we answered, it's on the events page on my website now, okay? And Michelle, would you like to say a bit?
I have some information here on the walk as well, and if you need any technical assistance, what you can do is give me either call, the number is 516-450-9129, or you can email me at michelle.gravatt@heart.org. So you see me after this or whatever, and we can help you do that. But it's going to be a great event. Again, Mind-Body-Soul Connection is just so into raising awareness and just being healthy and not worrying about fighting anything, just staying well and happy. So yeah, if you want any information about heart, just let me know. And welcome back.
Thank you. Thank you. So I wanted to make sure that you were aware of that. So now, and it doesn't mean you only have to go through my website. You're always welcome to connect with Michelle directly. But I thought it was kind of cool that we have a way that we can, you know, at least virtually be together for that day. Let me go over some of the other upcoming events that we have. For the month of October, the Enlightenment Power Group here will be on the 9th. The one in Manhattan will be on the 14th, and that happens to be Columbus Day. So if anyone has the day off and they want to take the trip in, there are some people there that also like to grab dinner together before the meeting, and there are some people there that also like to grab a beverage after. So if you do want to make the trip in there, I can set you up with some of the people that do that. We have a great, great group of people in Manhattan as well. And sometimes I'm always surprised that you don't know each other. It seems like you guys should know each other. You might have to pick a place between Plainview and New York City and meet sometime. October 11th, Friday night, I'll be at the Eyes of Learning. Even though it says on the website New York City, if you keep reading, it will say Hicksville, 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 Hicksville. Use your intuition and meet me in Hicksville and do not go to New York City. And I'll try to get that typo fixed. October 19th, I have a client who lives in New Jersey. I wish I could remember the name of the town, but I can't. But it is on the water. It's a really nice area where the people that I know there are very, very much enjoying this kind of information. It's evolving the amount of conversation that they're having about it and the events that they're having about it. The event was supposed to be in a yoga studio, but the yoga studio made a mistake and double booked the day. So it's been moved to one of my clients' private homes, but she invited anyone I know, which I thought was really pretty cool. And it's going to be in the middle of the afternoon on that Saturday. If you're interested in going, you can register online. We're doing the format of questions and answers, so everyone will be able to ask questions, get answers, and so on. October, I wanted to give you the heads up. I'm doing a virtual intuition development class. It's going to be 4 evenings. We haven't picked the date yet, but I did want to give you the heads up. It is going to be kind of the basic intuition development class, but if you've been with me before for anything, don't think of it as only beginners, because you know I always go into new areas. I never teach the same thing twice. Yes, it'll be relatively basic, but I'm sure that there'll always be new experiences. And for those of you who have been joining us here and you've never taken an intuition development class with me, it could be incredibly awakening for you. It could be very, very eye-opening for you. I think most people that take the class are surprised by what possibilities there are in their development of their own intuition. Far more opportunities exist than you might imagine, and you probably have more ability in different areas than you can imagine. So this gives you kind of a survey of all different ways possible to develop your intuition. We're going to keep it at a very small class, because online I like people to be able to see each other, so it'll be first register, first in. Okay? I also want to give you the heads up on this one, because I think this is going to be a really good event. And let me explain something. My computer crashed in August. So I'm really, really, really far behind on everything. But I have one thing I have new is a new calendar. And my old calendar had Sunday and Saturday together in one day. Now I have Saturday and Sunday on 2 days. So if you ever have a Friday or Saturday or Sunday appointment with me, please check that the date matches the day, because I've made the mistake at least 5 times already about whether it's a Saturday or a Sunday or a Friday. I'm going to get the hang of it, but apparently not soon. That being said, My intention is to have this event on November 2nd. I'm going to have a co-speaker coming in from Houston. I told him we're doing Sunday, November 3rd, which doesn't exist. So I'm not sure when he'll be here, but my intention is to be here on November 2nd, Saturday. I'm going to check with him, and I'll get the right date up on the website, but it's either going to be full day Saturday or full day Sunday of that weekend. And it's going to be a very unusual event. Yes.
Where is the location?
We haven't picked the location. It's going to be somewhere near here. It's going to be in a hotel or a conference center or something like that, but we haven't picked the location yet. I just wanted to give you guys the heads up. What it's going to be is I don't want to share the whole story about who he is, but he has an incredibly original story, and that's how he and I came to know each other. Like, today's the anniversary of my opening into this arena. He had an unusual opening into this arena as well. He is a former CEO. He's a scientist. He was, I believe, a nuclear physics scientist on submarines. He also was the man responsible for managing the 200 people that cleaned up the Exxon Valdez oil spill. So, and he was a CEO of a major company in Singapore for many years. This is not the guy that you expect to be sitting in this room, by any means. But what had happened is that he broke his neck, nearly died, long story. And when he was in a coma, his son was sitting at his bedside telling him not to leave. And he watched himself, and he watched his son telling him not to leave, and everything turned around. He was told he would be a paraplegic for life, or possibly a quadriplegic. He was told that everyone was told that he'd never have full brain capacity again. The man is 100% recovered. So he stepped into this arena through a different door than I did, but we get the same information coming from a different angle. One of the things he's become a specialist in is the science of numerology. And what he does is he'll give you a report. It's about 100 pages, personalized numerology report, and that'll be included in the day. And he's going to spend quite a long time going over it with people that are there to help them understand how to interpret it, how to utilize it, and how to help you to find your purpose through that particular report. I'm going to complement the day with another angle at finding your purpose, so we'll share the day. And I just wanted you guys to have the heads up, okay? Either the 2nd or the 3rd of November. Oh, man. And honestly, check those dates if you have a near-the-weekend appointment with me anytime soon. it's actually funny, but if I open up one more email that says, did you mean the Saturday or the 6th? I feel like, oh, shoot. Here we go again. And that's it, I think, pretty much.
What's going to be the format or the topic at the October 11th Eyes of Learning workshop? What are you doing?
Dominic?
Universal.
Oh, universal truth and...
Yes.
Yeah.
I was actually just seeing if they changed it. Okay.
Yeah, maybe.
It's
only said questions and answers.
Yes.
If you've never been to the Eyes of Learning, it's a great place. It's a really great place.
I'm a lifetime member.
Okay, lifetime member. And a lot of people that go there are lifetime members. It's very, very interesting. Place to see a speaker. It's a good group, really interesting group. So that's something worth coming out for as well. And then I have my regular every other month visit to the spa. If anybody ever wants any information about what that's all about, I'll be there for 4 days at the end of October. Okay? One other thing that I'd like to announce, because one of the people that usually here, I think he's invisible in the seat right next to Terry, right? Terry, would you like to just say what it's about for me?
No, it's okay.
Okay. All right. Scott, everyone knows Scott. He comes from Pennsylvania to be here. The Hay guy. He's doing a... Huh? Hey,
that's Chris.
He's a Reiki master teacher, and he's doing a Reiki circle on September 24th at 6:30 at the Long Island Photo Gallery, which everyone knows is the brainchild of Joanne. So if you have the opportunity to go there, how can they get more information?
It's the flyers are on the table.
Oh, I'm sorry. I did hear that, but I forgot. The flyers are on the table if you're interested. Also, just a reminder, because we haven't been together for a while, if you have anything going on, whether it's personal, business related, and you want to share with a group of like-minded people, you're always welcome to bring your own brochures and put them at the table, and I encourage everyone here to support each other's endeavors. Okay? So how are you all?
Good.
Good? Good. I was, when I saw that today landed on 9/11, first you get a hesitation of, well, you know what, maybe we shouldn't do it that day, maybe this month we'll do it on Tuesday or Thursday and have the group. But I thought, for this group, it's so appropriate that we're here together on 9/11, because there's a lot of things that we perceive from a different angle than the most of the world sees it from anyway. So it gives us permission to come together and talk about it from a different angle, and to talk about it maybe not with so much pain. That still is the conversation that's, you know, rampant outside of this room. And the other reason I thought that it was really appropriate is because this is the anniversary of my kickoff date. So for me, I know it's a day filled with so many mixed emotions and experiences, but for me it did have the benefit, the long-term benefit, of allowing me to find out that there's something more to life than just what we sense in our day-to-day physical experience. And my life hasn't been the same since I was able to begin to open it and have that conduit give me information that I find to be far more valuable than the information that we get on Earth. So I thought that was appropriate that I should share my anniversary with everybody here.
Happy anniversary.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. Thank you for sharing with me. Before I start talking about 9/11 at all, there was one thing that was really interesting that happened. I don't know if anyone in the room knows, but I'm psychic, right? So I pull up and I have these thoughts. I felt so overwhelmed with the love of people that I know through this work, now knowing each other. They have independent relationships that don't include me. And I'm filled with joy. But they have independent relationships, and there's so many incredible crossovers. Every now and then someone will come through my news feed on Facebook, and I'm like, how does she know him? How does she know her? And it all comes down to this room or some event or something. And to me, that's incredibly exciting that so many people have met each other and that they're sharing their lives with each other in as many ways as, like, Scott having his Reiki circle at Joanne's place. So I came in with this feeling, and it felt really exciting to me. And so I walk in, and I start to see people that know each other only through here, and they're hugging, and they miss each other, and all this. And I'm thinking, that's really cool. And then I notice in the back, two people I've never seen together in a room before. It turns out that they're neighbors. They live across the street from each other and find out that they both know me. So I thought that was all really cool, because here I am thinking about it when I walk in. But nothing could compare to the story that I heard right before I came up here. Would you like to share?
Sure,
Joey?
Absolutely. I lost my recording studio in Hurricane Sandy. It was in Brooklyn, had 6.5 feet of water. And since then, a lot of companies that I'm affiliated with and endorsed me as an artist came forward to help me. So Samson Technologies is a big company that's always helped me. And today, I had to go pick up the gear that they were going to supply for my new studio. And who's there? I meet with Evan Hay.
Evan?
And so he helped me gather all the gear today and bring it out to the truck. And we spent about an hour together. Mm. And I pull up, go to walk into the building, and who's standing at the door? I haven't looked at him.
Oh,
And it was fun. It was funny because like I'd been backing him off for a couple of days because I had like, you know, I had to like
get
the gear together and get all the gear checked out. So I was like, I can't do it today. I can't do it today. And just backed up today. So.
Yeah, and he said Wednesday's good.
Yeah. So actually, we have like big meetings in the office. We were gonna do tomorrow, and then we have big meetings in the office. So everybody wanted to get it done today. So I was like, oh, come today instead of tomorrow.
And then a few hours later, I pull up, and there's Evan again.
that blew me away.
It blew me. It blew us away.
And the interesting thing about it, I know Evan's not a familiar face in this room, but Evan doesn't live close, and that's why he doesn't come to the Plainview meeting. So there's a lot of wow in there. So I guess I must be psychic because I'm sitting in my car thinking about all the interconnectedness of us all and just appreciating the way the ripples keep moving and moving and moving. And that's good news. And I want to look at 9/11 and how we perceive 9/11 today coming in from that angle. In the very beginning when I would start to talk about it and tell people what my experience was on that day, sometimes, every now and then, I'd meet someone that had a personal, intimate happening on that day, and it was challenging for them to accept that anything good could come of such a horrific crisis, challenge, day, whatever. But I think that now, with the years that have gone by, there's a lot more people that are certainly aligned with the fears that it has incited, and fear-based behaviors. But there's also a lot more people that were driven toward finding more love in their lives and questioning what the meaning of our reality on Earth is here, what the meaning of our own personal journeys are. And I feel like there is a little bit of a separation now about the reaction toward 9/11. There are those that are hanging in the emotion of anger, fear, not being able to comprehend things, not being able to integrate any benefits or seeing any possible benefits that have really come from the experience. And then we have the other side on the opposite end of the spectrum of people that are doing things differently. They're thinking differently, they're feeling differently, they're believing things differently. And I think that's mostly who winds up coming to things like this. And I know there's such a strong pull to be talking about it and the sadness of it and always remember, and always remember. If you've ever noticed, I don't put posts up like that. I don't put that kind of thing in my newsletter because I think that it's important to remember that it's an event, and every event has polarization. Every event can be perceived from the lens of negativity only, or it can be perceived from the lens of positivity. And if you keep encouraging only the look at an event through the lens of what is negative, then that's how it's going to be cemented. And like when, if you were here for the day when we were talking about changing your past, once you take that Sharpie and you put a label on a box, you never go back and take that box out again and relabel it. So it's important that we encourage people and let people to start to have a little bit of wiggle room in their perception of the events of that day. There is a lot of good that has come. There's a lot of good. In my view, it has been an enormous catalyst for an acceleration in enlightenment among people. And some people, you don't really understand what the word acceleration means unless you just took physics in high school. But acceleration means that it's not going at a constant rate anymore, that it's going faster and faster and faster, which means it keeps going faster and faster and faster. And if you think about people's ideas from 2001 to 2004 or 2005, and then think about what people were talking about from 2005 to 2009, then start thinking what they were looking at from 2010 to 2013, you can see that there is an accelerated shift toward enlightenment. There were topics I would talk about in 2007. I was like one guy hanging out on a limb all by myself, and people were, their mouths were down at the ground, they had no idea what I was talking about, I had to slow down for a lot of audiences, and today I can put anything out there, and everybody picks it up really fast, or they get it. They get it very quickly, because even if you're not accelerating at the same pace that maybe your neighbor is, your intention to become aware makes you able to absorb and digest and use information that resonates with truth or resonates with universal wisdom far more than you were able to before. So I do like to see 9/11 as a catalyst for good change. And I also like to remember on this day that the souls that were involved and the souls that returned home on that day, they're not experiencing any of the agony or angst that we choose to experience here. They're understanding that it was a grand catalyst for change. When we're not in our physical bodies, we don't care about time because there's no such thing as time. So it matters not to us whether we were living for 9 days or 90 years. What matters is how on earth we were able to increase other people's ability to give or receive love, or how we were able to increase our own ability to give or to receive love. 9/11 was just one vehicle to allow that to happen in an accelerated way. So those souls are still actively working all the time, guiding people on earth, trying to help people who are only stuck in sadness and helping them to find a different angle and a different perspective, trying to help them to get unstuck. And also to take the people who are already shifting and seeing things from a different angle and try to help them with their ripples so that that movement can spread. And that can grow from shore to shore. So those souls are still a part of our lives on a day-to-day basis. Whether you knew them or not, they're a part of the fabric of our journey here. And as there is no such thing as time, they feel a sense of an increase in their vibrational energy because they can be catalysts in the increase in our positive level of awareness on Earth. And yes, it's difficult for the families that are connected, but in every lifetime, everyone will experience a loss at some level or another. And with a loss, the more challenging we perceive the loss, as difficult as it might sound, we do have a choice. We have a choice. We have a choice how long and how hard we will allow ourselves to feel badly about it. We're not meant to be unhappy on earth. Yes, we have things to process. Yes, we have things to think about. Yes, we have growth. Yes, we have a lot of stuff going on. It doesn't mean that you can go from something like that to pure joy overnight, but you still do have a choice about how much you will allow yourself to agonize over anything that happens in your life, period. And so it's my hope that more and more people that were directly affected on that day also become catalysts for positive change. I know I talk in here a lot about how we have become very fear-based. Fear is an energy that is the absence of the energy of love. And it has the same effect on our reality as hate has. The weird thing about fear is that fear is encouraged. Hate is sort of no longer encouraged for the most part. Blatant hatred or prejudice, you got to be living in a dark space to pull that off anymore. But fear is advocated and encouraged everywhere. You can't go through a day without someone telling you to be safe or don't eat this or don't drink that. You can't face a day without being bombarded by other people's fears. But because people are thinking that they're doing something from a place of love and helping to protect you, then they're encouraged to share their fears with you. So it's not something that we're going to know how to snap out of. We can't have the same awakening that we had about hatred. Hatred has evidence, and sometimes it's expressed through violence. It's expressed through discrimination. It's expressed through unkindness and isolation. But fear is not expressed in a way that we're going to want to take back the freedom of not being afraid. So what I ask people to do when we talk about this topic is that you can be one of those catalysts that doesn't get involved in the fear bandwagon. Don't jump on it. Don't encourage other people to be afraid. Even if you are hearing something and it's making you feel fear, don't share it. Keep it to yourself for a moment and contemplate, why do I want to speak about this? Is it for my benefit or is it really for your benefit? So think first before you fear. Think first before you fear, okay? And start to decide that the more people who choose not to live in fear, the more the world is going to continue to accelerate and get to a place of positive energy, getting back to the vibration of love where we all belong. I know we're heading there. Things that were told to me by guides in 2005 and 2006, I've got 6-7 years under my belt watching the things that they told me would happen come true. In the beginning, I was very tenuous. It sounds like a huge mystery if you get information about the future, and I don't want to step on anything or put myself out on a limb even by declaring it. But now with all of these years under my belt, and I see exactly what they told me happening beyond a shadow of a doubt, so I no longer feel doubt that we are heading in a direction of an increased positive level of awareness for all of humanity. You're going to see pockets. You're going to see whole countries that seem to separate or seem to fall off the love energy vibe. But those small concentrated pockets command an enormous amount of attention for how small the numbers are that are involved in it. So the attention that they get accelerates everybody else's comprehension of what we will no longer tolerate. And it helps us to become more aligned with how we want the world to be and how we want to live. I'm not one to, you know, bash any one particular group because there really is no black or white, but it is important that you keep your independent thinking on and active and fully charged whenever you're watching anything that comes from the media or you're reading from the media or you're listening to anything that comes through a political forum. You have to have your independent lens on. It doesn't mean that it's all false, but it does mean that a ton of it is not true. Okay? So use your independent thinking about it. And I know that sometimes we feel powerless because we elect our officials and then they make decisions that we don't support. But you do have a voice. You do have a voice. And with the power that we have of social media now, you can use your voice in ways that are positive and not inciting anger. It's not about fighting a fire with lighter fluid. It's about saying that to put the fire out, you have to do so lovingly and with love, with the energy where you want to go. That's the only way you're going to shift from where you don't want the world to be. And you can be passive, you can be quiet, you can be all of those things, and silence is better than feeding it. But if you ever find just a good little opportunity to be one of those catalysts for positive change, the universe is going to make openings for you to do it. It's okay to do little things. As I can tell you, you're not going to lose any friends or family over it. That's the remarkable thing about it. Because universal wisdom does resonate. You don't have to be in your face with it. People who are ready to hear something that can help them to be happier are going to make the way for you to come in a little bit by asking you a question, by following your lead, by asking you how you did something that's different than the way that they live. They're going to make these openings when they're ready to hear something that you could give them a value. So it's not about, you know, standing up at a pulpit and declaring that everything out there right now is so bad and so evil and so wrong. It's about just gently being a catalyst for change in your own day-to-day life. And then certainly, if you want to take it beyond that, then take it a little bit more beyond that as well. I know that there are people that like to talk about certain things that I no longer believe in, and I don't tell people that they're wrong, and I don't participate in the conversation on the level that they're on. If I feel that there's an opening, I might just say something like, I see it a little differently, and then I'll make one sentence about the different way I see it. Then I change the subject to something that the speaker wants to talk about, and all the energy goes away. So I don't feel like I have to be in your face and debate about it or tell them that they're wrong or, you know, hit them at the core by criticizing anything that they said or did. People don't like to be criticized, you know. I always love it when people say something like, you got to learn how to take criticism. You know what? I don't have to learn how to take criticism. I really don't, because it's not fun, and I don't like it. But if there's something that you could suggest that I might benefit from knowing, you might be able to critique something or speak about something in a kind way. You don't have to criticize. When you criticize something, what somebody says or an idea or what they wear or who they're with, you're stabbing them in their self-made identity, and you're telling them that they're not worthy. At some point or another, that's how they will take it in. And everybody is worthy and lovable, no matter what their level of awareness is. So use a different technique rather than criticism. Don't fight what isn't connected to the vibration of love by not being connected to the vibration of love. All right? So that's my viewpoint about 9/11. And I hope that everybody in this room has had some very positive growth simply because 9/11 did happen. Think about that. Yes?
There's 2 points. This morning I attended a memorial service down on Lido Beach, and the flowers are starting to bloom. The children of those that were lost on 9/11 that morning are starting to become old enough to start to speak. A lot of them do not remember anything physically about a parent, a grandparent, or whatever, but the love is clearly there. And it's amazing to listen to them speak now about what, you know, how they feel and think about that person very frequently. So it's very pronounced. And the other thing is, on the way here, there's a woman on the radio. And she said, well, 9/11 doesn't need to be a sad day. A lot of children were born on 9/11. Yes. We have a birthday party for my daughter. Yes. And she says for us it's a celebration. So, you know, that's
really important. And you know what? I have to tell you, Anthony, that you had a really intuitive moment there. Because the next thing that I was going to say is that I have personally decided to not make it a black day anymore, mm-hmm. because there are a lot of people born on that day. And I have a very good friend born on 9/11. And I celebrate her life, and I celebrate her. And I do everything that I can to make sure that she's valued and appreciated, and that her day isn't contorted. Because why should it be contorted for the rest of her life? No? And that I totally agree with you. It is a day, and people are born on this day. People are born on this day. Interestingly, I know that there's someone that knows whom I'm speaking about, but one woman that I loved, her still lover, she's just, we can only communicate in a different way now. The other channels don't work anymore. The earth channels aren't working there. She lost her son on 9/11, and what was really fascinating was the way that she turned her focus about the event was that she brought people together. Her son was a young man, and she brought together everyone that he knew from his whole life, from high school, through college, through his work environment, and she would put together this amazing, like, sporting event weekend where the guys just came to have all-out, full-throttle sports all weekend, and they raised money, and they had a blast. Oh, and so that was an amazing way that she converted the energy and she transformed it into something new. But the last time I had spoken to her, she's passed away, you guys figured that out, right? But the last time I had spoken to her on Earth, there had been 31 children that she knew of that were named after her son.
Mm-hmm.
And that was over a 10-year period. So I love to think, you know, all right, now one of them is 3, one of them is 7, one of them is 5, one of them is, you know, and I like to think about them growing up. And I know that there'll be more kids named after him. And I love to think about that these children have no connection to the day, personally, because of when they were born, but for their whole lives, they'll connect it to something beautiful and wonderful. So when they're 70 years old and their grandchild's sitting in their lap and they say, hey, Grandpa, how did you get your name? He can say, well, that's a really interesting story. Let me tell you. So for the next 70, 80 years, we're going to have all these little minis out there talking about the good of it. I was born and I was named for that event. And so the ripples are out there, and they're not going to stop. They're going to continue. And once again, it's our privilege to get those ripples out there. Okay, so I wanted to talk about tonight.
His name?
Huh?
What was his son's name?
I can share his name, right? Mimi? I can share his name, right?
Scotty?
Scotty. Yes, apparently I can.
Scotty.
I was going to say Scotty, but I said I didn't know, you know. I should keep it private, but his name was Scotty. So, yeah, very cool, very cool, very cool story. So does anybody have any questions?
That's like similar to people who have losses in their lives and make something positive out of it. The Apocores lost their son playing lacrosse ball, and they have gone out there and really promoted AEDs, et cetera. We had an event last night, and they're up to 74 saves.
Wow.
Yeah, 74 saves. And they had, last night we had an event where the people who saved and the people who saved them came together.
Oh, nice.
Gave the people who saved them an award. And they both did the last award was a young man who was a sophomore in high school who saved his mom.
Wow.
And it was like, it's amazing. So, yeah, you get it.
Yeah.
You do. Yeah.
And a night like tonight, to go full circle here, me coming and pulling up and thinking about the interconnectedness of us all. When the universe gives us opportunities to witness it and to appreciate it, like the situation between Joey and Evan to me is when the illusion just disappears for a moment and you glimpse truth. Then we're going to fill it all in with the illusion again, but that is real. That is real. I know I've probably told you the story before, but there was a time when I was at an event and it was a cocktail hour, and I was I pretty much try to stay, you know, relatively human when I'm not at an event like this, right? And so I'm at an event and the waiter comes up to us and asks the person I'm talking to what drink he wants, and they go back and forth on an exchange about the beverage. And I'm sitting here, I must have completely left my body, because I'm watching them and I'm just completely confused. Like, why are they pretending that they don't know each other? Mm-hmm. He's acting like a waiter, he's acting like a patron, he's pretending he doesn't know what he likes to drink. And I'm like, wow, that's just so weird. Like, what are they getting out of it? And it was just maybe 5 or 10 seconds that I felt like that. And then I snapped back into the illusion. And I'm like, oh, I forgot. They don't remember that they know each other. It was such a weird little bounce out, you know? I left it alone. I hadn't had a drink yet, and I didn't want them to cut me off before I had my first. Yeah.
What I find most interesting about 9/11 is the architects of that day had meant it to put the world in one direction. And, I mean, it did in a way, but it also pointed the world in the other direction.
Yes.
And in a sense, they're actually triggering their own demise.
Yes. I have to say that I agree. Yeah. That's why Evil. How does the guy say it?
You evil.
Evil.
I think I'm right on the going.
There with you. Evil clubs. I'm like, what am I keep kicking? And it's the marker. Evil clubs don't work. They come back and they bite you in the butt. So don't plan anything evil with that.
As they say, karma.
Yeah.
It's a phrase that we use in today's times, but karma, it always gets settled. Hmm.
I have a slightly different view of karma, but I think the basic foundation of the idea of karma has some truth. I don't believe it means an eye for an eye, or it doesn't involve anything to do with punishment, but it does serve us in us attracting energy for awakenings that we haven't discovered. That's more of the way that I look at it, you know? But yes, and it is a popular term now. Yes?
I have a question. When you were talking about the interconnectedness, like what just happened with the two of them, how do they connect? Is it their vibrations are matching that's bringing them together? How does that work?
I remember in my learning years, and I know Jeannie remembers this, there was some, I don't know if I could ever put it down in a book or not, but there was some incredibly freaky things that happened. And it got to the point that I said, if I put this down in a book, no one will believe what's going on. Because it was so, how would you describe it?
Surreal.
It was so surreal. I was not in this normal physical reality. I was only seeing things through the perception of how we really are unified. And things were happening that had been put into motion in the 1970s that I was uncovering, but I didn't know that I was meant to uncover it because guides would send me there under a false pretense because I would never go there if I thought I was looking for something that I didn't think existed. All of this stuff, magic after magic after magic, happened. And it was almost too difficult to explain, and it was almost too profound in the way that it worked out so beneficially. I mean, I can't, the profundity of it just blows me away still to this day. But what I started to do was I started to think about like the mathematics of everything that was going on those 2 years. And not only I was just opening it those 2 years, but what had happened for decades before to allow me to uncover all of this stuff in 2 years. Physical evidence was allowed to be found by me on Earth, meaning souls understood that it had to be there for me 30 years ago, okay? You can't make this stuff up. And so as all of this was happening, I started to try to think of the math of it. And I realized that we think very linearly, and we think in terms of the finite, whatever our brains can wrap their heads around. If you can count to a million, you can think up to a million. If you can't count to a million, you can only think up to the number you can count up to. And so we can't comprehend the magnificence of the way that souls are guiding us all, interacting with us all, planting good ideas in our heads, not to overtake you, but to allow you to have these good ideas and allow them to emerge. And all of this interconnectedness, sometimes a million things come together in a second. Mm. A million things. And if it doesn't happen, guides will get back at it and do other ways to make these things happen. And those who become awake, those who become aware of another level of life, they're the ones that get to see it and know it and feel it and witness it, more so than those who are living entirely as humans. So my answer is, we can't comprehend it with just a human brain.
So I'll make a long story short. We've been together a long time, like 24 years, Michelle and I. When we were kids, I was touring. I've been a touring musician. So something had happened at a festival, at a carnival, where a bunch of girls mistake Michelle for someone else over a guy. Okay? I was extremely upset about it. She called me on the phone. I was in Texas touring. And she was upset because it was an altercation and stuff. It was a mistake. Anyway, fast forward 10 years. We're in a Rollin' Roaster in Brooklyn in a restaurant. And we're online. And for some reason, I never met this guy, this person who this was about. And this is fast forward 10 years later, maybe 11 years later. And the story, for some reason, popped into my mind about what happened then, right?
Remember that happened?
So we're at the table eating our food. I'm sorry, sweetie. And we eat enough
food. That's why they're together 24 years.
Yeah, they're amazing because they're like 30, right?
No, I'm 42. So we're eating our food, and I just wanted to say, I said, what happened that time with that time that happened? And she goes,
he's right there,
walking up. And I never met this person. She said hi, and she didn't see this.
Wow.
He was walking up behind me.
Wow.
That was the most extraordinary thing that...
So like, you are the witch.
Pretty much.
Not Michelle. Not Evan.
No. It's me. It's me. Something's going on.
That's funny. That's good.
Wow.
Okay. Tonight, the topic that I'm going to be talking about more than I already have is really about energy. I just want to talk about energy and how we use it to create our reality. I want to go... like more from the really higher perspective about energy. Mostly here, we talk about the day-to-day stuff and we interpret what's going on in our world and in our communities and in our individual lives. But today I want to talk about kind of top-down. What is it that you need to know about how to make your life happier, and what are some good things to know about your energy so that you understand the power that you have? It's not just philosophy, it's not just theory, it's the truth about what you can know about yourself to affect your reality. I want to make it in pretty simple terms tonight. But it's 8 o'clock now, so we're going to take a quick break so you can hug the people you haven't got a chance to hug yet. Grab a cup of coffee, and we'll convene in 7.5 minutes. Thank you. I had an experience like that. I was walking in the mall, thinking about somebody, and all of a sudden I walked smack right into them. They were lighting a cigarette. I thought I was going to shatter them. Okay, so we're all back. We're all back to talk about energy.
Okay,
all right. Interestingly, on that little bit of a break, I had at least three more of these really cool interconnected stories come up. It's really mind-blowing, and very, very much ever-present here tonight, for sure. So that was cool. Thanks for sharing, everybody that shared some really, really, really interesting happenings. All right, I want to talk, and then I did have some people ask questions. And one, my intention is to answer in the second half of tonight. So I'm going to just dive right in, and hopefully her questions will get answered, because it's a very, very, very good question that she put forth. But I want to talk in terms of, everyone knows the formula that I put on the blackboard every month. What's the formula about how we manifest our physical reality?
Woo!
It was a little weak, but I heard all the right words.
Alright, I don't know it.
I'll put it up here again. So the formula is what you think and what you feel and what you believe, and then the subsequent actions based on what you think and feel and believe, the actions that you take, creates your physical reality. And it is interesting, no matter how many situations I've seen with clients or I've discussed with people, you can't get out of this formula. It always works. Sometimes people try to say, well, what about this or what about that? As soon as they're stating the circumstances and the result, we always go back and we find the missing link in the formula, and we find why their physical reality is different than what they were hoping for, because there's something in this equation that wasn't supporting what their what they believe their goal to be, okay? Now, the only way that this is oversimplified, because this is really darn accurate, is that this is true for the individual, but it's also true for the collective. So even when you're watching what you are thinking and feeling and believing and the subsequent actions that you take, you don't live in a vacuum, you know? I don't have you wrapped up in bubble wrap, protected from the energy of all of society. So you are co-creating with humanity. The more intimately connected you are with any people, the tighter your relationships, the more of a cross connection you have between people, the layers and levels of your relationship, the more what they think, feel, believe, and their subsequent actions are going to have an imprint on your physical reality. Okay? And then even beyond the people that you travel with, the entire collective, what they think and what we all think and feel and believe together, and the subsequent actions that we collectively take, also have an imprint on our individual physical reality. Now, the thing about it is that the more you learn to use your energy in accordance with this formula, the more you're going to direct your journey in a very, very, very positive corridor. And the less imprint there will be from those you're intimately connected with in a negative way, or people in general. The less that other people will be able to negatively affect the corridor that you live in. If you've ever heard any of these scientific stories about, like, someone that can, I never really looked into the science of it, but there's been enough that sounded somewhat credible. Someone who could go without eating and drinking, somebody who can have the manifestation of objects, someone that can do this, someone that can do that. You know, there are people that can live in freedom from any external influence changing their positive reality. Mm-hmm. And what they've done with their brains and their thinking and their feeling and believing is so absolute that the energy that they're putting out there absolutely creates the reality that it is that they want. But we're pretty much not like that. You know, we all have our masks and layers. We all have our misbeliefs. Mm-hmm. We all have hidden misbeliefs that we can't remember. So we all have these little energies inside that are making the reality that we want go askew. Some of us it's going way off, and some of it's going a little bit off. But that's the reason that your physical reality might not look the way that you want it to look, okay? So the first thing that I want to do, a lot of people in this room are familiar with this tool that I use called energy sticks. And I brought them with me tonight. First thing I want to do is I want you to explore the difference between how your energy, if it's positive, affects reality or goes out into the universe, and how your energy, if it's negative, affects reality or goes out into the universe. For me, in this journey, as I'm listening to guides back in 2005 and 2006 and trying to uncover all this stuff as fast as possible, for me, there were certain things that changed my perception of reality forever, for the better. And this tool happens to have been one of them that really worked for me. So what I'm going to do is I don't have enough open energy sticks for everyone to have their own pair to play with. But what we're going to do is I have five people who have volunteered to demonstrate them with me, and then I have another bunch of sets that are open. So the people who are demonstrating with me will then help the people who are in their immediate area. So everyone gets to try out the sticks. Okay? Maybe it'll be the thing that gives you a profound aha moment. Maybe it won't be. I know it profoundly affected my perception of how important this formula is. Okay? Now, most of my volunteers are on this side of the room, so I am going to ask two of my volunteers to come to this side of the room and mingle with this side of the room. But Jeanette volunteered, and Mimi volunteered, Anne volunteered, Victoria, and Jeannie. They're going to be my volunteers. So I'll ask Jeanette to go onto this side of the room and Anne. I don't know why I'm retentive.
And I'll take this for you.
Yeah, if you
I don't know, sorry.
Yeah, we got it.
Thank you.
Oh, you're good.
I do.
I have my car.
What do you have?
All right, so here's how it works. There are some other people in here that have tried this in other groups with mine. So this is really just to help those of you who have never seen them before, okay? These six that I have in my hand are ones that I made for years out of straws and hangers. And for many, many, many years, I tried to find a manufacturer, and I even had helpers trying to find, and we didn't have luck for probably 4 or 5 years. But I finally was able to find a manufacturer for them, and so now I can, you know, now I can have people have their own set. But this is what they look like manufactured, all right? I'm going to be using the ones that I made tonight, just so we have some extra open ones, rather than opening all the packaged ones. But if you really want an extra pair to play with tonight, I'll open up the packages as well. But we do have some that we can play with tonight, okay? There's a slight difference in feeling and sometimes a slight difference in the way that the sticks work for you based on if you're using my homemade ones or using the ones that I had made. But for the most part, once you get the hang of it, I do find that everyone seems to have better results with the ones that were manufactured for me, okay? So see if you can try to get your hands on those. All right, the idea is that you stand with the sticks about 8 inches to a foot apart from each other, maybe 10 inches apart, and you make them become parallel to each other and parallel to the floor. Now, if you can see, I'm not doing anything to touch the metal, but you might want to touch the metal in the beginning just to get them to be steady. But make sure that you're not touching the metal in the long run because you don't want to touch anything except for the handles. The handles operate independently from the metal. Once you have it steady, tuck it into your chest because that's the area that you emit the greatest amount of energy. That's where most of your concentrated energy comes off your body. Okay? So you want to put it where most of your energy is coming off you and going out into the universe. So tuck it into your chest, keep them parallel to each other and parallel to the floor. And then what you're going to start to do is you want to think about something that makes you feel really uncomfortable, whether you feel angry,
what were you thinking of?
What did you do?
Well, just went like this.
Or think of something that makes you feel angry or resentful or fearful or jealous, anything below the line. Everyone knows my below the line diagram. So think about something that makes you feel really, really below the line and see what happens to the energy sticks when you think about something that makes you feel below the line. Okay? As you can see by Victoria and Jeannie and Anne, and they have had the result of thinking about something negative. And I'm going to make them not think about anything negative anymore because it's unpleasant. So let's turn our energy. We'll recenter them again. And now we're all going to think about something that makes us really happy and makes us feel filled with love or joy or whatever else we can possibly think that's way above the line. And see if there's a difference in your energy sticks as a result. Okay? So, it's wild. So I call these energy sticks because they measure not the fact that you're emitting energy, but they measure whether your energy is going out into the atmosphere in a positive way or in a negative way. And once you begin to see the result of how your energy is going out there, you become incredibly conscious of your feelings. So no matter how much you want to create a certain reality, you recognize that you've got power. If you're putting energy out there that the universe is witnessing as being positive, you became a positive energy magnet. You will attract back to you like energy. Now here it is not a secret anymore. You can think that you're putting positive energy out there, but the sticks are going to tell you if you're above the line or below the line. So what I did, now we're going to take our models here, are going to hand them to different people who haven't had a chance to try them, and we're going to use these sticks. So everyone, they're going to help you to try for yourself. Okay?
Is it better if they stand up?
It is. I find it easier to stand, but it's entirely up to you.
Maybe no points to me.
I don't want to talk to
All right, I'm going to open up some more packages so more people can try. Who would like a pair?
Yes, please.
It's all right. You know what? Put your hands.
Thank you.
You won't be as nervous. Yeah, just open them.
Yeah. So the positive opened up, and the negative was starting. Betty showed up. My dog's in the car.
How much are those carrots?
Pull them straighter. It looks like you're down. Yeah.
Are you filming? She was supposed to
come. We had an argument.
Here's my other baby boy.
And now, I'm going to say,
Let's see a show of hands. Who had a result where they could see the difference between their positive and their negative energy? Wow.
I'm a believer.
That's incredible. Absolutely incredible. That's really neat. Listen, if I had it, you guys know I don't like the marketing end of my business. It doesn't make me comfortable. But I tell you, I think that this is a great thing for you guys to have for your benefit. If you do want to purchase them, they're $12. You can purchase them tonight. I had them, I picked all the colors. I had so much fun designing the colors of them. So there's a huge variety of different colors you can choose from. You can also buy them on the website, and I'll have them here regularly every month from now on at the monthly meeting as well. If I had it, I tried to have, the only one they messed up on was I wanted them to make a rainbow, and they didn't follow my instructions. They put the beads in the wrong order, but in my heart, it's a rainbow.
And you waited for this show?
Yeah.
She knew she got the rainbow.
But anyway, Mimi was helping me for the longest time trying to find a manufacturer for them as well. If I hadn't had such amazing results with it on my own, I wouldn't have worked so hard to try to find someone to manufacture these for us. All right? Now, let me just explain to you, if you have a pair for yourself to use, here's one of the things that you can do with them. When you feel yuck, or when something happens that makes you mad or distracted, or any emotion below the line, you can feel yourself, your energy changing. Basically, you can think about what we say: if you're closed, everything's closed in, and if you feel open, everything feels open. So you can almost understand why the sticks work the way that they do when you think about how you feel like sitting when you're unhappy and how you feel so much freer when you're putting out positive energy and you're inviting people to come in. If you go to an event and you don't want to be there, you don't feel like talking to anybody, you're going to be standing there like this, right? And then you're not going to be a magnet for someone that's feeling very, very open. But if you're feeling open, you tend to use your hands when you speak, you have open body language. You can actually witness it in other people, what kind of energy they are emitting in any given moment. So what I would start to do is when I got that moment where I was feeling uncomfortable or below the line, I would pick up the sticks. And sometimes I would do this 5-10 times a day in the beginning. And what I would do is I would use the other tools that I've learned over all of these years about how to get myself above the line. So I'd use all of those other ways of getting myself above the line. And I would keep picking up these sticks again until the sticks opened. And I trained my body and my mind and my feelings to understand the difference of what it was like by putting something positive out there. Once I found myself dominantly putting positive feelings out there, everything in my world started to change. I was bringing in happier people into my life. People that had challenged me or I found challenging to be with, they started to gracefully leave. Mm-hmm. I found that people found me more interesting than they used to find me. And it was all because my energy was changing. Fundamentally, I increased my vibrational energy. Now, the tools can help you see that your energy is changing. You still have to do the work behind it. All the things we've talked about, all the things written in the book, all the things that we know, you have to do the work to get the sticks to open. You have to release judgment. You have to know that everybody's doing the best they can within their level of awareness. Blah, 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 blah. Every single thing we've ever talked about is the way that you get to live with the sticks open. But at least this lets you see your progress. And at least this lets you begin to discover how you really are emitting your energy in different circumstances. So that's why I'm very, very happy that I have them available now after all of these years of not being able to have them available. The funny story is, over all the years, I made like 40 to 50 pairs of these, and I used to bring them to seminars, and I used to bring them everywhere we went, and I used to use them all the time. And at the end of the night, I would have fewer than I arrived with. And this would happen year after year. And this is what I have left. This is it. So I started when I only had like 4 sets left. There's one missing. When I started
to... You told us to buy it.
Oh, I'm joking. I was actually joking. But I know which ones you took, right? I would start to joke when I was down to only 5 sets left. I'd be like, just so everybody knows, there's been metal detectors installed at every end. So now I don't have to worry about it anymore. But I hope you got something out of it. And even if you only use them here and you got to see how they react, you have enough of a different idea about the energy you're emitting and the way that it goes out there into the universe than you did before you came here tonight. Okay? So, we really concentrated on feeling. When we think, the power of positive thinking, there's a lot of people that make the assumption that when you think positively, it's going to bring you the life that it is that you want. It's not true. It's only a little piece of the equation. And the way that I like to demonstrate how it's only a piece of the equation is I want you to think of a celebrity that you have the hots for, okay? And I want you to think about that celebrity and really focus on him or her and, you know, imagine yourself maybe, who knows what you would want to do? Rowing a boat on the lake, you know, who knows? But imagine it, and so you can think and feel really good about being with that celebrity, right? Now, do you think that that's going to cause the result of you being with that celebrity?
No.
Why not?
Hasn't worked so far.
Because you don't believe it's possible. You don't believe it's possible. Okay? You do not believe it's possible. So every element of this equation is there.
What about the stalkers? They thought it, they felt it, they believed it, they took those actions.
And they finally came face to face. And then, again, the subsequent actions. I like to use the example of someone who has a great idea for a screenplay, killer screenplay, okay? They understand how you create reality, so they write this screenplay, and it's just awesome. So they're thinking about it, feeling fantastically about it, and they actually believe, because they've been doing this work for a while, but they actually believe that it's possible that this screenplay is going to get onto the big screen, okay? Then they take the screenplay and they put it between their mattress and their box spring. What happens? Nothing. Nothing happens because they didn't take any action based on what they were thinking and feeling and believing. So the reason this is all by itself, in accordance to what you think and believe and feel, is because ultimately you have to take action in order to have your reality manifest the way that you want it to manifest. Okay? I could say that if I wanted to lose 30 pounds, I want to lose 30 pounds by the end of the year. I want to lose 30 pounds by the end of the year. I'm thinking about it. I'm feeling really good about being 30 pounds lighter. I really believe it's possible. I think it's the time of my life I can really do this. And then I change nothing. Nothing. I am not having subsequent actions that are in accordance with what I'm thinking and feeling and believing. Therefore, nothing will change in my physical reality. So each one of these is an important part. It's easy to think of these and gloss over them because I put them up here on the board every single month. But when you really start to think about them and think about areas of your life that might not have gone the way that you want them to yet, but you've been believing or thinking or feeling in the direction of that goal, now you can find the whole. You can find which part of the equation wasn't adding up. All right? Now, I want to address the bigger picture. Because we have a collective reality, what people commonly believe, our collective conscious energy, it sticks together. So when people have like thoughts collect. And the more like thoughts, the more similar thoughts there are out there, the bigger the collection. It becomes like a thought ball, okay? Think about it like the little wispy clouds in the sky. Any one of them is just a vapor, but then when the vapors start to collect, now it starts to look thicker. And the more they hang together in one place, the heavier they get, the darker they get, the blacker they get. This is what happens with conscious energy. Negative conscious energy collects to create storm clouds, okay? And the storm clouds can only hold so much negative energy before they burst and they release that negative energy. And that's the explanation simplified behind why we have group crises. Group crises are created by collective conscious energy bursting and releasing. It's the explanation behind Sandy. It's the explanation behind Katrina. It's the explanation behind weather patterns that seem to be devastating. It's because human conscious energy connected and collected to the point that it collected so much negativity, the earth had to release it because it couldn't hold it anymore. Okay? The more an entire region is having a lot of collection of negative thoughts, the more a weather pattern will affect a very large geography, which is the explanation behind Sandy. If it's one particular town or one particular area or neighborhood, something will happen in that little area. Sometimes there'll be so much collected negative conscious energy all over the globe, things will just start exploding all over the entire globe and get released all over the place. But that's how it works. So the important thing to remember here is that Reality doesn't create you. You create reality. Nothing in your physical life happens first. And that's something that's hard to wrap your head around. Nothing on earth happens first. Everything happens in human thought first. Human thoughts collect to change and create and form our physical reality. And the reason it works like this is because our journey is to awaken. Our journey is to vibrate closer and closer to the energy of love. And we don't have the capability of understanding how our individual or collective energy is affecting our physical reality until we witness it. When we witness it, we become curious. And only when we witness it and become curious can we choose a different perspective. Can we think outside of the box that we were already in? Can we think that maybe there's a different reason behind what just happened on earth than God is cursing at us? You know? And we start to see that there's cause and consequence that result from what we're thinking and feeling and believing and the subsequent actions that we take. We start to witness it in our individual journeys. We get to see the power of that formula. Then we start to notice it in the collective power, how collectively we're reshaping our earth reality. There's two examples that I think really demonstrate this beautifully, and I've given you these examples before. I don't think there's anything wrong with hearing the same examples again, because you guys keep continuing your path of enlightenment, and you might even understand it from a new and different angle when you hear it tonight. But one of the first examples is AIDS, okay? Hatred is about as below the line and vibrating in the absence of the vibration of love as you can get. As I told you, it's also the energy of fear. So when there was a lot of expression of fear and hatred toward gay people, the fear and the hatred and the actions that people were taking based on their fear and their hatred started to collect and collect and collect. So it doesn't work that the universe will then say, let's give a disease to the haters. It just doesn't work like that. It's opportunities for discovery. If a disease came upon the haters now, who's going to learn anything? No one will learn anything. There'll be no discovery. But I'm going to talk about it in the male gender, because primarily in the 1980s, this affected more men than women. And we were aware of its effect on men more so than we were aware of the effect on women then. So if you were a gay man in the 1980s, you had a very strong personal journey with your gayness. You had to come to terms with it on your own. You had to make a choice about whether you would tell anybody about it, who you would tell. Would you act upon it? Would you pretend you weren't? Would you tell some people and not others? Would you have a dual life? Would you hide it? Do you feel shame? Do you feel happiness? Do you feel liberated when you make the discovery? Are you lovable? Do you love yourself? The numbers of things you have to deal with as a person in that moment is extraordinary. We shouldn't have to manage all of that in one short period of our lives ever. It's overload. So now we have a spectrum. We have the spectrum of those who live openly and those who keep it a secret, even to the point that they stay with the opposite gender only. And in that extreme, AIDS starts to enter the picture. So those who are living openly and those who are not living openly now cannot hide it if they have the disease, if they have the virus. Maybe you can stay away from everyone that never knew you were gay, and you can still keep your illness a secret. But if you have any connection to the people that you had loved, it's going to get back to them that you're sick and that you're dying. So now there's a new arena of people to think about gayness, and now they have a choice. Their choice is, do I love without conditions on my love? Do I accept? Do I embrace? Do I judge? Do I hate? There's a big choice to be made. And as we know, it ran the gamut. Some people rejected people with AIDS. Some people would visit and hold hands and kiss and hug. Others would disown and act as though that person, as a member of the family, never existed. So now the person with AIDS and the people who are dying have another thing to manage. Now that I have a disease that everybody sees me as literally the worst pariah on earth, that some people can't even come near me into my physical presence, do I have value? Am I worthy? Am I lovable? Am I loved? What's the purpose of my life? And so then they have another whole process. So the enlightenment that came, the possibility for discovery that came all over through AIDS was an opportunity for people to awaken. Men and women who had rejected their children because they were gay, when they found out that they were HIV positive, many of them embraced them again and started to say, my stupid ideas are not as important as the love of my child. Many of them started to say, my religion is stupid for making me think I should reject my child because the most natural thing in the world is that they've discovered that they're gay. So now all of this other stuff, it's not just the people, it's everyone around the people. And it just goes on and on and on. And that's how the universe works. When we individually or collectively separate from a universal truth, the universe is going to give us opportunities to discover the universal truth, period. So now let's talk about fear for a second and put this in the light of fear. The other example I want to talk about, which I know I've talked about before, is nut allergies, okay? I know it's more interesting to tell it like a fable, but there were some peanuts hanging out in Georgia. They were on the plants. And far, far, far away, a little boy died. And they did an autopsy. He had no medical history. No one could figure out why the boy died. And someone said, do you know that the day he died was the first time he ever had peanut butter? And everybody said, oh, he died of an allergy to peanuts. That's right. And a lot of people spread the word because they had a little boy and they wanted an explanation for why their boy wouldn't die for no reason. So by giving an assignment of a cause to the death of that child, they felt safe again that their other child wasn't going to suddenly die. And at the funeral, hundreds, thousands of people shared the story of the peanuts. And it didn't stop there, because a few months later, a little girl died a few towns over. Same thing. Autopsy shows nothing. Same thing. Somebody said, you know that she had peanuts the day she died. And you know, I heard about the little boy who lived in Fear Town, that he died because he ate peanut butter that day. Yes! Big sigh of relief for everyone that has a child. My child's not going to die because my child doesn't have an allergy to peanuts. So they spread the word because it makes them feel safer, okay? What happens is these thoughts about why the child died start to collect into these storm clouds. And then the storm cloud comes over to Georgia, they were minding their own business, those little peanut plants, and it rains down on the plants. And the plants are like, you've got to be kidding me, I didn't hear the news. We kill children? And we're like, yes, no, yes, we kill children.
So now all of a sudden, the peanuts start to take in this information that they're responsible for causing death among children, and their physiology changes in response to the information. You never heard of a kid dying of a peanut allergy in the 70s, 60s, 50s, 40s, anywhere, ever. Now, what is it, 1 in 10, 1 in 30? The peanuts were able to respond to the collective conscious energy of humanity. Fear causes these crises, not the earth. The earth echoes what we fear, so we can see mirrored out outside of us the product of what we're thinking and feeling and believing. That's what the earth's job is, to echo us. The earth echoes us. So the reason I ask people to not be one who passes on fear is because every person that collects a fear together with another person is shifting something in the universe. Everyone is shifting something in the universe. It was really interesting. The older cell phones, they used to have the antenna. And all of a sudden, there's this big thing about cell phones cause brain cancer. No one had any evidence. No one had any reason to support it. But people were saying it left and right. Then there was a study that came out, I think it was in Switzerland, where they did brain imaging of people who were using cell phones for an extraordinary amount of time every day, like 8 hours because of their job or something. And they found in the brains of the people that were using them that much that there was a darker patch in their brain near where the antenna touched their head. So now this report comes out. Now everyone's convinced that cell phones cause brain cancer. But you know what they forgot in the report? They forgot that when they read the report, they said there's nothing unhealthy about those cells. They just shifted. They're not cancerous. They're not diseased. That part was never picked up by all of the people that continued to spread the fear about cell phones causing cancer. Luckily, we had enough things to fear other than cell phones at that moment. So we all redirected our energy and we made sure that wheat started to kill us and dairy started to kill us and eggs started to kill us. So you're relatively safe now with your cell phones, okay? Because cell phones do not cause brain cancer. The point is that everything starts with you. Everything starts with your perspective. Everything starts with what you think, feel, believe, and the subsequent actions that you take based on what you think and feel and believe. No matter how much research is done about anomalies or patterns that are popping up, if you think that there's been a negative body disharmony in a particular region, and you're trying to show something in the environment that caused the people in that area to get sick, I'll tell you something happened long before the earth could have triggered an illness. People became afraid of the earth. They became afraid of the tap water. They became afraid of living near a dump. They became afraid of something. But something had made them so afraid that something in a community could actually trigger body disharmony. That's how it goes. Whatever happens physically is second to what we think and feel and believe. I know I've shared this story too, but I don't suggest that you try this at home until you have a very clear belief system. But when another report comes out about a food being unhealthy and they take everything off the shelves quickly, everyone, you know, quickly they abandon that food, they throw away what's in the refrigerator, it's taken off the shelf, they go on with their lives, they talk about, oh, I was going to make a spinach salad last night, I was so glad I watched the news because who knows, I could have died. So they go on with their lives. But does anyone sit down and think, how many people are out there who make their living by growing spinach? how many people are out there making their entire living off growing tomatoes? How many people had to not send their kids to college the following year? How many people were devastated because even after the crisis of one batch of tomatoes or spinach was taken off the shelves, people were too afraid to eat spinach and tomatoes for a long time after that? How many lives were ruined because of our fear? So what I always did was I ran down and tried to buy whatever I could off the shelf before that particular store got the memo. So I would buy the spinach, I would buy the tomatoes, I would buy whatever it was, and I would eat it. And not only would I eat it, but to really tantalize my family, I would rip the bag open and eat it from the bag. No triple washing, no peroxide, no chlorine. I'd eat it from the bag. And I hit the jackpot when cashews were the thing of the day, because they don't have a shelf life the same as spinach and tomatoes. So I went down to Trader Joe and I bought tons of cashews because I could eat those cashews for months and months and months. And I knew I couldn't help the tomato grower and the spinach grower and the cashew growers and the transporters of those things or the grocery stores that sold them or anyone else that had a piece of profit that came from those foods. I knew I couldn't help them individually. But I felt like by eating this stuff and not choosing to be afraid and to demonstrate that there's nothing to be afraid of, then I could at least put some kind of ripple of benefit out there for them. And I would send it out trying to send the love to them. I would send the love to those who were affected. And that's energy. And I have a belief system that there is not a food that will harm me. So I can eat anything and I can be okay with it. Because foods will not harm me. My plane is not going down. I'm not getting hit by a Mack truck. I'm not getting double pneumonia because I went outside with wet hair. I am safe. My body supports me. I am healthy. I haven't been to a doctor in a really long time. I don't need to go to a doctor because I am safe and healthy and my body supports me. But as I said, please don't try this at home. Don't try it at home until you're very, 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 very clear about what your belief system is. But at least you can start to take tiny, tiny, tiny little shifts to getting out of your comfort zone and embracing something that other people are afraid of, and to see that it's okay. Every little tiny thing that you put into the universe helps to dissipate the dark, dark, dark clouds. If we leave them alone, they will burst. But if we do things to try to add some light into the darkness, they will evaporate. So that's the tool and the strength that you have with your energy. It's not only about creating your own individual physical reality, but you are a contributor to the collective physical reality of all people forever. As long as you are on this earth, the choices of what you think, feel, believe, and the subsequent actions that you take contribute to the direction that humanity goes.
Question. The lack of hurricanes this year, that attributed to the more positive attitudes then of people in the region?
I'm using an oversimplification of it, but a lot of our angst got rained out with all of the storms that we had last year, including the tornadoes, the floods, the hurricanes. You know, there was this anomalous weather pattern pretty much all over the country and then all over the world to some extent. So a lot of it got washed out. But now, as you can see, as things are happening and heating up in Syria, and this is going on and this is going on, things are starting to collect again. The other thing is that when that washout came from Sandy, there seemed to be a slight shift in the economy. So people were starting to breathe a little bit more easily. So they weren't as fear-based as they were while they were very, very afraid of their own economic positions. So I, you know, something else is collecting now. Something else will burst, and now it will be in response to what we are being told in the news about Syria, the Middle East, Egypt, and so on. It'll be in response to that. I don't watch the news, but you know, you do get to find out what's going on. It's a choice. It's a choice. It's always a choice. You know, intuit who you want to put your faith in. Intuit who you want to put your faith in. Okay? Everyone feel good?
Yeah.
All right, let me leave you with a positive thought. Every positive thought that you put out there today, tomorrow, or any day has more energy than an equivalent negative thought. So you could have 10 non-productive thoughts in a row, and then you can burst them all with one really happy thought. Positive energy is so darn positive that it eclipses negative energy. So it only takes one of us to eclipse 10 people who are focused on the negative. When you remember that, it becomes even more fun to be playful and whimsical about how positive you really want to be. So go out there and be positive and playful and whimsical and fearless.
If for nothing else, you just know.
And I'll see you guys all next month.
We'll call you.